Good afternoon. May it please the court. My name is Kate Demarest and I represent the state of Alaska in this appeal. I'm going to do my best to reserve about 5 minutes for rebuttal if I can. The only question in this case is what is the meaning of the word work week under section 102A of the Family and Medical Leave Act of 1993. The district court created its own novel definition that, quote, a work week is time that an employee is actually scheduled to work. Now that definition has some superficial appeal to it, but when we dig just a little bit below the surface, it becomes very clear that that definition just cannot be correct. There are two parts to our statutory interpretation argument. First, the plain language, and second, the structure of the statute, specifically the statutory distinction between continuous and intermittent leave. And my goal today in the limited time that I have is to add one hopefully helpful point of gloss on each of those parts of our argument to what we said in the briefs. So first on plain meaning, I'd like to give the court just a very quick example that I hope will clarify exactly why the district court's actually scheduled definition must be wrong. So think of an employee who is working a traditional 9-to-5, 5-day-a-week schedule with weekends off. And this person schedules a vacation for 2 weeks in July. But then at the end of June, this person experiences an accident, which requires them to take a 12-week continuous period of Family and Medical Leave Act leave. Now, the fact that this person had a previously scheduled vacation in July does not extend that person's period of FMLA leave to 14 weeks. Because continuous leave can only be taken in, quote, one continuous block of time. That's the regulatory language, and that's the distinction that's baked into section 102A and B of the statute. So this person does not, their leave does not stop during their previously scheduled vacation. So the actually scheduled to work language, that example demonstrates that that definition, at the very least, can't be it. That can't be right.
But counsel, when a person takes FMLA leave, aren't they also entitled to exhaust their annual leave and their sick leave? So the example you're providing is a person who has 2 weeks of annual leave that they could withdraw their leave slip, take their 12 weeks of FMLA, and then take annual leave or additional time that they need to make up for whatever their exigent circumstances that required FMLA leave in the first instance.
Employers can require people to run their other types of leave consecutively with the Family and Medical Leave Act leave, but that doesn't really affect the answer to the question because those 12 weeks, whether or not the employer allows that person to save those 2 weeks of ordinary leave for later, which most employers do not, some do, but either way, it's going to be a 12-week continuous period of Family and Medical Leave Act leave. And no other kind of leave is going to affect the fact that it is one continuous period and cannot be stopped in the middle and then restarted again using a different kind of leave. They will run consecutively at the same time if that other kind of leave is forced to be used by the employer.
So, but you're posing a hypothetical that I think our hypotheticals have to have some grounding in the real world. So you're saying that the employee couldn't take this consecutive leave, that it would be intermittent if they had a break in the middle with annual leave. Okay. But if under these circumstances they decide that they need to take the 12 weeks of FMLA leave, why wouldn't the annual leave that they've accrued then be tacked on at the end? I mean, how could that possibly be a real world scenario?
Well, it is a real world scenario. First of all, most employers, as I said, will require the person to exhaust their ordinary leave. So most people go back after a maternity leave with no ordinary leave left because it has been exhausted. Your paid leave has to be exhausted at the start of your...
Okay, well, that's my point exactly. It would be exhausted at the start or at the end. Why would it happen?
Exhausted as part of the 12 weeks. I'm not saying you get to exhaust your paid leave and then start your FMLA leave. Your FMLA leave starts immediately and the paid leave runs out at the same time for most employers. Some employers are generous enough to allow the person to save their paid leave and still have it when they come back at the end of the FMLA leave. But that distinction does not affect the analysis here, because in no event will that, if that person is allowed to withdraw their leave slip, keep their paid leave for later, then they will have it, but they won't be on FEMLA leave anymore once they start that. FEMLA leave is exhausted, and now they're on a different type of leave after the 12 weeks.
So your distinction on intermittent and continuous leave is because they have a right, the employee has a right to continuous leave, but not to intermittent leave. So yeah. The employer could approve it, or there are some circumstances where the employee is allowed to have intermittent leave.
Yes, intermittent leave is the exception. Continuous leave is the rule, and intermittent leave is allowed only if it's supported by medical necessity or if it is approved by the employer. So the point that I, moving directly to the structure of the statute in this continuous and intermittent leave distinction, the point that I wanted to add here today is that, so the only case that is quite exactly on point with this one is from the District of Oklahoma, and that is the Murphy case. And that judge relied almost exclusively on the existence of language in the last sentence of Section 2612B, which says basically that when you're on intermittent leave, you cannot count time, quote, beyond the amount of leave actually taken. And the statute, the canon of construction that says the existence of that language in B and the absence of that language in A makes a difference, that is the only analysis that the Murphy court judge did. And the secretary's brief sort of suggests that that's our primary argument too. It's not. There's a far simpler way to understand the significance of the continuous versus intermittent leave distinction in our argument. And the point is that there are only two types. There's continuous and there's intermittent. And leave has to be in one of those two boxes. It cannot be in both. It can't be some species that's in between. And so, that's based on the mandatory language of the statute that says that leave shall not be taken intermittently unless it's medically necessary or if the employer agrees. So you're either in that category or you're not. And then the regulations define these two categories. Intermittent is leave that's taken in separate periods of time. Continuous leave is taken in one continuous period of time. And the statute has a limit, a cap, that says 12 work weeks of leave. So what the district court created is either one of two things. It's either one continuous period of 24 weeks, which violates the statutory cap of 12 weeks, or it's 12 separate periods of time that are separated by something else that isn't leave and isn't work, and that becomes intermittent leave in 12 separate blocks, and it's not supported by medical necessity or employer permission. So that also violates the statute. And so the argument that I'm making is not this canon of statutory interpretation argument that the Murphy judge made. It's really just that whatever kind of leave employees on this rotational schedule are given, it has to be one or the other. And what the district court did is something else. So that has to violate the statute. It cannot be right. And the touchstone for intermittent leave, all of the cases agree, all the cases that we cited, mostly in our brief at page 26 to 28, they all make clear that the touchstone of being allowed to take intermittent leave is the availability to work. So if you're not available to work in between the intermittent leave periods, that's not intermittent leave. It has to, then the employer can say this is a continuous period of leave. Excuse me.
Well, it seems like, you know, a critical issue here is what does work week mean?
Yes.
And your argument, you referred to weeks. You didn't say work week. And that's the critical language in the statute. So when it caps it at 12 work weeks, what does that mean? Is a work week just a continuous period of 7 days, regardless of whether it includes time the person is going to be on some other form of leave or vacation or the employer's closed? I know the employer being closed situation is dealt with in regs, but or is it a week in which the person is scheduled to work? I mean, I think that's sort of the crux of the argument. And what does the term work week mean, and how do we decide that?
That's right. And the way that we have to decide that is by looking at congressional intent in 1993. And
well, don't we start with the plain language of the statute before we go to try to intuit congressional intent?
Right. Well, the plain language of the statute is the term work week. And what is a work week? And The only...
If they had interpreted it the way you want us to interpret it, Congress would have used the word week.
I don't think so, because work week was already right there in Title 29 of the United States Code as a technical labor law term that had had a very specific labor law meaning since the 1960s. So the Fair Labor Standards Act in the regulations had since the 60s defined that term, work week, to mean a, quote, fixed and recurring period of 168 hours. And so Congress legislating in this field in the early 90s would have been very, very familiar with the existence of that term. And
but isn't it true? I mean, Congress was legislating for different purposes. So in the Fair Labor Standards Act, it was important to define a specific period of time for a work week to prevent employer mischief, where they could not pay an employee for overtime. So, you know, they would divide up or define the work week in such a way that the employee wouldn't be credited for overtime. Whereas in this instance, it's providing a benefit of a certain amount of time. And it seems on your argument that the court could have said, you know, the employee will be entitled to 12 one-week periods of 168 hours instead of saying 12 work weeks.
Well, that would be, I mean, the block is 168 hours. That's 24 times 7. That's not the number of hours of leave that a person gets. So the Secretary's acknowledged how common it is for courts to look to the Fair Labor Standards Act for a source of definitions of terms in interpreting the Family and Medical Leave Act, and even goes so far on page 33 of the brief to concede that a work week in both statutory schemes is based on a fixed or established period of 7 consecutive days. So the purpose isn't just to prevent employer mischief, and I would argue that it serves exactly that same function here in the Family and Medical Leave Act as well. It's to create a temporal unit of 7 days around which to organize wage, hour, leave, all of these things, and they have to be done consistently. There's just no reason to think that Congress, when it used that very specific and somewhat strange term work week in 1993, that it intended something other than what that term had very long meant in the labor context for decades at that point. And in terms of the other point that I really, well, I'm gonna reserve the rest of my time if I can, because I'm well into my rebuttal. Sure. Thank you.
No worries. Thanks very much for your argument. We'll hear from opposing counsel.
Good afternoon, may it please the court. My name is Rachel Goldberg. I represent the Secretary of Labor. And I want to begin by homing in on what has already been discussed in terms of the plain language and the importance of the word work week. And that is certainly extremely important here, but you also have to look at it in context. It's 12 work weeks of leave. So both of those phrases are very important. And I completely agree with your honors that work week does refer to a week of work, and that it wasn't just a week, and it's not hours of leave, it's not days of leave, it's a week of leave, a week of work of leave. But there's the always I'm using the word leave, because this is fundamentally a leave statute. It provides a federally protected right to be absent from work for up to 12 weeks that the employee would otherwise be at work. So it's leave from work. And if you don't have any work that you're scheduled to perform, you're not required to be there, then there's nothing for you to take leave from. And so both of those words are crucially important to resolving this case. And then the plain language of both those words answers the question presented here.
Can I ask, why wouldn't the more rational and sensible way to go about calculating leave entail, let's say for someone who has a regular schedule, all right, not I guess what the situation is here where the people's schedule can shift around all the time, but let's just say somebody worked 80 hours one week, 0 hours the next week, 80 hours, you know, the following week, et cetera, and that was their regular schedule. Why wouldn't the more sensible way to approach it would just be to calculate the total number of hours of work they would be scheduled for over that 12-week period, and then just use that as the baseline for whatever calculations would need to be made in the intermittent leave scenario. Because the continuous leave scenario just doesn't strike me as a problem at all. It's just you conceive of the person's regular schedule as Work week one, 80 hours. Work week two, 0 hours, et cetera, et cetera. But it's still a work week. The problem that I think your interpretation is trying to address comes up more in the intermittent leave situation. And it seems to me just taking the total number of hours somebody would be entitled to over a defined period makes it much easier to calculate, to run all of these calculations. So what is the problem with taking that approach?
Well, there's a couple of responses. First, in terms of determining the amount of intermittent leave an employee is entitled to take and when they use it, how that leave is accounted for, an employer can convert their, if an employee regularly works a 60-hour week, the employer counts that person has 60 hours per week of intermittent leave to take. And when they take hours 1 week, they've taken 1/6 of a week, or, you know, there's different ways of doing the math, but you do often convert it to hours when it is intermittent leave. And that is certainly sensible and very common. The department's regulations address that. However, when it is a continuous block of leave, it is typically in work weeks. And that's how Congress wrote the statute. It is 12 work weeks of leave. Congress did 168 hours of leave or X number of days of leave. It said 12 work weeks of leave. And so when in both instances, you begin both continuous leave and intermittent leave, you look to the employee's work week to determine what their leave entitlement is.
Yes, but in the scenario I pose, the 80 on 0, 80 on 0, the person, all of those are work weeks. They're just, their allocation of hours for the middle weeks is just 0 hours, but it's still a work week because the employer's not shut down. There are continuous operations. That's just the person, what they have is a certain number of hours that they are going to work over a 12-week period, and they're just allocated in a, you know, kind of unusual way across the 12 weeks, but each one of those is a work week. It's just that some of the work weeks, 0 hours are assigned.
Well, yes, from the employer's perspective, those are each work weeks, but it doesn't make sense for an employee to take leave in a work week in which they were scheduled to work 0 hours. What are they taking leave from that week?
In the intermittent leave scenario, I understand that. I agree with you. But in the continuous leave scenario, that makes no sense because you are going to give that employee what will end up being 24 weeks of leave when Congress only allowed for 12.
It's not, but I think that's I can understand why a person would view it that way, but when you get down to it, they're not being given 24 work weeks of leave because they weren't scheduled to work for half of those work weeks. They were only actually expected to be at work for 12 of those 24 work weeks. And so it's a continuous period of time in that they are gone for each work week that they were otherwise expected to have worked. It is cumulatively totaling 12 work weeks. It spans 12 calendar weeks. And I get the kind of gut reaction, well, that seems like a lot more than a traditionally scheduled employee who only gets 12 calendar weeks. But the fact of the matter is that employee was only scheduled or expected or required to work 12 of those 24 work weeks.
I disagree with that characterization from the employer's standpoint. The person has, there are 12 work weeks there. The employer has just allocated to certain of those weeks 0 hours, but it doesn't take them out of the realm of that being a normally scheduled work week for the employer.
Well, but you don't look at it from the employer's perspective and that they are operating and so it's a work week for them, even though a particular employee who needs leave isn't happen to be scheduled. You have to look at it from the employee's perspective. And that's true both of intermittent leave and continuous leave. For intermittent leave, obviously, you look at the individual's work week. If they happen to only work part-time, they work 1 day a week, they get 12 weeks of 1 day a week of leave. And it's true if they happen to work 80 hours 1 week, they get 12 weeks of that. But those off weeks, there's no, it would deprive those employees of the federally protected right to be absent from work given to them. It's not just for the employer. The employee has a right to be absent from work for 12 weeks that she would have otherwise been expected to have worked.
Council, could I change gears a little bit and ask you about the degree of deference that we owe to the secretary? Do you want to speak to that?
Sure. I think the deference is a little bit of a red herring here, and that I don't think the district court decision turned on deference, and in any event, this court's decision need not turn on deference. I think the plain language of the statute answers the question here.
But I'd like to have you speak to deference, please. What's your position?
To the extent that we would maintain that our position is entitled to Skidmore deference. It's certain, we would never argue that it was entitled to Chevron deference. It's Skidmore deference.
But why, counsel? Why?
Because it is consistent with the regulations, consistent with the preamble statements that accompanied the regulations when they were promulgated in 1995. Consistent with opinion letters, and is consistent with the plain language of the statute. And so it's a reasonable and we believe persuasive position. The fact that we have not had occasion to address this.
That's my real question. Let's get to that. Maybe I didn't ask my question very precisely, and forgive me for that. Has the department ever, a secretary ever taken this position before?
We have never had occasion to address this particular scenario of a kind of a rotational employee who has weeks on, weeks off. So,
okay, hold it. Yeah. I'm not talking just about I understand that answer to speak to litigation. Yes?
Correct.
Okay. Is it written down anywhere? Is there a policy, a manual, anything, even internal?
As to this particular scenario, no. However, I would, you know, I believe that there are statements in the preamble, which we cite in our brief, that are more general, but I do think answer this question, which is that if you are not scheduled to work, not required to work, you don't need a leave of absence to take leave to cover a period, that does not count as FMLA leave. And our position is
extraordinary to me. I think that's what you said in your briefing too, but this was enacted in 93.
Right.
And it's still, this has never been litigated.
No. The two cases, two districts.
Yeah, but I mean, the secretary has never been involved in litigation. Taken this position, has not had to stake this out?
No. It's a novel position. A novel scenario that we had to confront in this investigation, yes.
Okay. Thank you.
And I will say, in terms of not having ever expressed it elsewhere, two things. One, it isn't a position that we developed during the course of this litigation. It is what prompted, when we were investigating this employer, it's what prompted us to find violations and then file suit. So it's what prompted this action in the first place. So I think it's a little bit different than a typical APA challenge where in the middle of litigation at the agency's coming up with a novel interpretation to justify their prior action. And second, Skidmore deference, you know, to the degree it's persuasive, and there's various factors that go into that. Certainly a longstanding is a good indication of a position deserving deference, but it's not required. The persuasiveness, the consistency with the statute are other factors that are very relevant to Skidmore deference. So for that reason, I think our position here is deserving of Skidmore deference.
Thank you.
In response to one of my opposing counsel's arguments about how the district court here created the third type of leave, it's neither continuous nor intermittent, there's no reason to view this leave in that way. This is a continuous block of leave that an employee takes over all of the work weeks that the employee is expected to work. They are not working. It is a continuous block for one leave reason or another. You know, the typical might be a maternity or paternity leave. So the fact that absences occur in the middle when the employee wasn't even expected to be at work, doesn't somehow convert it into some kind of weird new hybrid form of FMLA leave. It's continuous leave, and it's subject to all the same, you know, obligations and requirements that the continuous leave is subject to.
Sorry, I was muted. I wanted to ask you a question.
Sorry.
I was yapping along, but you couldn't hear me because I had my microphone on mute. I'm sorry. So I'm puzzled by the statement that the secretary hasn't taken this position before. And so I was looking back through papers, and you mentioned the preamble, but there were comments and questions when the statute was enacted, and the final regulations were promulgated in 1995. And there was a commentator that asked precisely this question about how a week of FMLA leave would be counted for employees who work 7 days and then are off for 7 days. And then the department answered precisely the same position you're taking here, that it would be only the work weeks. And so it seems to me that's a fairly strong argument for the secretary to say this is not a position we've created in litigation. This is something we said back in 1995 when the regulations were promulgated. Am I wrong that has no significance that the secretary has said this since 1995?
No, and I completely agree. I think those are very persuasive arguments and very on point. In hindsight, of course, we wish we had written our regs a little bit differently in that to mirror what exactly was said in the preamble. But because we said in the preamble, yes, noting that a commenter had asked, what about a week on, week off type schedule? And we noted that when an employee is not required to be at work, they cannot be charged leave for that. And we cited the exact provision, which is frequently cited in both parties' briefs here, 825-200H. And I do think it is very much on point. My only hesitation in not relying too much on it, not kind of overplaying what I think is a strong interpretation, is the resulting regulatory language didn't use as an example a rotational employee. It used as examples where a plant closes for repairs or a school, a company is closed for the holidays. So I do think the preamble is very helpful, both at that page and at a later section at page 2229, where we again said that if you're not required to be at work, an employer cannot count that as leave. Yes, I think those significantly bolster that this our position now is flows naturally from what we said then in 1995 and has been consistent throughout the years since then.
Thank you, counsel. I don't think there are any further questions.
All right, thank you very much.
I'm sorry, did I hear something? No. Oh, maybe that was just some feedback on my.
No,
okay.
Maybe.
Thank you both for your arguments. We'll go ahead and take that case under advisement. And that completes our arguments for today.
Judge Christian, I think that the state's counsel has a little bit of time left on rebuttal.
Is that right, Ms. Emmer? You do. But I beg your pardon. You saved 2 minutes, 2.5 minutes. Go right ahead.
Thank you.
I'm looking at the wrong clock. Sorry.
That's just fine. I appreciate it. I'd like to start right in with Judge Beatty's question about the preamble. That argument is exactly what Judge Burgess relied on in the Truitt case, and the district, those two precise parts of the preamble are what he relied on. And the district court here correctly recognized that those parts of the preamble were concerned with the taking and counting of intermittent leave, not continuous leave, and so they have no applicability in this case. And the secretary has nonetheless revived the argument that those things somehow should affect how to count continuous leave, but they don't. And Judge Watford raises, I think, the point that makes the correct result in this case the most clear, which is that when you're doing continuous leave, there's only one way to count it, and the basis is work weeks, and it's 12 work weeks.
Can you just drill in that? What do you mean there's only one way to count it?
Well, there are no regulations that say here's all the detailed way to count continuous leave. All of the regulations about how to count the leave concern intermittent leave. And that's because continuous is just very simple. It's one continuous period of 12 work weeks of leave. And so it should be straightforward every single time. But when you look at the intermittent leave context, where there's you know, lots and lots of different scenarios, that is where you have to do this math that Judge Watford was suggesting. And the employee's normal schedule is always the touchstone of how to calculate the number of hours of intermittent leave that the employee gets. And when you take two people who are, one of them is taking their leave continuously and the other one is taking their leave intermittently, it's not going to be exactly one-to-one, but in general, they should be away from work for about the same number of previously scheduled hours. And under the secretary's interpretation, the person who's taking intermittent leave is going to be away for twice as many of their scheduled hours. 84.
I appreciate that. I'm just puzzling over your statement that there's only one way to count it, but maybe I'm taking your statement too literally. So that, yeah. Go on with Park, and I'll stay out of your way.
Well, that was the point that I was trying to make, that, you know, there should be parity, and it should be parity in terms not only of work weeks, but of hours. And somebody who works 84 hours in a week, if they are allowed to take 12 of those off, is going to have 12 times 84 hours of scheduled time at home, away from work. It's going to be one continuous period of 24, whereas the person who works, who takes that leave in a continuous, the person on an ordinary schedule is going to get half as many of their previously scheduled hours. So it's the secretary's interpretation that gives certain employees twice as many hours away. And the way to fix that is to interpret it just to interpret the term work weeks to mean the very same thing throughout all of Title 29. And there's no reason to think that Congress intended otherwise.
So this fairness argument that you're making, I only found it in your reply brief. Which I find troubling, because that means the secretary didn't really have any opportunity to respond to it. Can you cite me the pages where I've missed it, where this is in your opening brief?
It is in the opening brief. I've got it right here. It's certainly pages 30 and 31. It's the last argument where I compared a theoretical person on a traditional schedule to a person on a rotational schedule, and how many hours of away from work they would get and how much time away from work. That's it, just off the top of my head, that's where I'm finding it right now. But we definitely made that argument in the opening brief.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, now are we done? Nothing further? Okay, good. We'll go ahead and stand in recess. Thank you both so much for your helpful arguments.